I'm Anthony L. Elmore, president and founder of the Proud Black Buddhist World Association. We at the Proud Black Buddhist World Association bring to you another exciting Black Buddhist lecture. We are not only the Black Buddhist voice in America, we are the Black Buddhist voice in the world. Now, our lecture today is Buddhism, Elvis Presley, the White Man. Now, a Black Buddhist lecture. Let me make one thing clear. It is my heartfelt prayer to remove the Buddhist teachings out of the realm of Asians and bring Buddhism to the realm of everyday life. This lecture again is called Buddhism, Elvis Presley, the White Man. The point of this lecture is not about the white man. The point about this lecture is Buddhism. The reason we bring up the white man is to move Buddhism away from the realm of Asian teachings and bring Buddhism to the realm of everyday life. You see, the Buddha or the teachings of the Buddha did not arrive until Asia 1,000 years after the death of the Buddha and another 400 years before it got to Japan. Now, however, when we look at Buddhism, we relate Buddhism to Asia or Asians. However, the Buddha was born in what we know as Eastern Ethiopia. And there were black people. It was not white people. It was not Asian people. Now, Buddhists come from the Indus Valley civilization, and there is no archaeological evidence of the people who came from Magadha ever being white, because at that time in history, there were no white people in India. Now, or what we call Eastern Ethiopia. Now, it was the 13th century Japanese Buddhist sage Nichiren Shonin who challenged all of the Buddhism in Japan, whereas he declared that the only true Buddhism was and is the Lotus Sutra, the highest of the Buddhist teachings. Now, most people who study Buddhism look at the world from the standpoint of Buddhism and not from the standpoint of the Lotus Sutra. Now, Nichiren writes, now there is a gosho, it's called the gift of rice, and Nichiren kind of explains the Lotus Sutra. He says, quote, the great Buddhist teacher Malo compared these passages with the one from the sixth volume of the Lotus Sutra that reads, quote, no worldly affairs of life or work are ever contrary to the true reality. He revealed their meaning and pointed out, although the first two sutras are profound, since their meaning is still shallow and fails to approach that of the Lotus Sutra, they relate to secular matters in terms of Buddhism, whereas the Lotus Sutra explains that in the end, secular matters are the entirety of Buddhism. Now, how much more secular can you get to talk about who the white people call the king of rock and roll? Now, my lecture again is Buddhism, Elvis Presley, the White Man. You see, Elvis Aaron Presley is not just a man. Elvis Presley is a white man who is whiter than white. See, Elvis Presley represents white supremacy. And it is the Lotus Sutra that explains the concept or the delusion of white supremacy. See, in regards to many white people in America, Elvis Presley is the king. Now, let's go into a cause and effect relationship to explain why white people call Elvis the king. You see, the Buddhist religion is not, whereas if you are black, you find that Buddhism is upon some mountain and you meditating. The true Buddhism is a religion, is staying alive in a system, whereas a white police officer cannot kill you or black people unabated. See, the Buddhist religion is being black and trumps America. See, Donald Trump said, let's make America great again. See, he means to make America great again, he wants to go back to the history, whereas white America, via legal segregation, was allowed to discriminate against black people. See, this is the America that Donald Trump wants. See, in the Trump's America, or in the old white America, white people want the old advantages they had to take advantage of other people, to exploit their labor like they did our ancestors in slavery. Now, the purpose of this Black Buddhist lecture is to bring Buddhism to a 21st century paradigm and relate Buddhism to our everyday lives, culture, and history. See, please understand that we are the proud Black Buddhist World Association, and we teach Buddhism in regards to culture and history. See, one of the greatest iconic heroes in America is Elvis Presley. Now, growing up in Memphis, Tennessee, whereas some white people label Memphis as the birthplace of rock and roll, this gives me a depth and a deep relationship and understanding of Elvis Presley and rock and roll. Let me explain this in a way as a matter of fact. There is no Buddhist in the world that has a deeper karmic relationship to Elvis Presley than Anthony F. Elmore. While I never met Elvis Presley, I grew up just a few miles from his home called Graceland in Memphis. I personally knew many people closely associated with Elvis. Where you have the Elvis fans in the world, Elvis's best man and best friend was George Klein. Now, when I was just a teenager in 1968, I was then a colored singer in an all-white band, and we performed on a show that George Klein had called Talent Party when I was just a kid. Now, later in life, I became the world karate kickboxing champion. And as a world kickboxing champion, Elvis Presley earlier had brought in to teach, this is like in 1973, 1974, there was a world middleweight karate kickboxing champion, a PK champion by the name of Bill Superfoot Wallace. Now, I was just beginning to study karate, and Bill Superfoot Wallace, Elvis brought him in to teach at a karate school that he had opened in Memphis on Cleveland Avenue. I went to that karate school and I challenged Bill Wallace and we tangled. Now, also at that school was Red West, who was the bodyguard of Elvis. And Red West was at the school, so I personally knew Red West. Later in life, George Klein and I did a play-by-play commentary on a kickboxing television telecast. And the last time I saw George Klein a few years ago, he was a casino host at one of the casinos in Tunica just down the road. And George complimented me a dinner for me and my wife. So I go back closer to Elvis. Now, the people that took over Elvis School, that's my friend Patrick Wren. And a few years ago, I was inducted, me, Bill Wallace, and Central Rothroff, and some others, we were inducted in the Elvis Presley Memorial Karate Hall of Fame. So I have a deep relationship with Elvis. My brother, to this day, lives right behind Elvis' house called Elvis Presley Cove. Now, Elvis loved karate more than life. And I could assure you that had he been living when I won the world title in 1982, he died in 1977, just 5 years earlier. But had I been living, certainly Elvis would have communicated because he loved to take pictures and associate with world champions. Now, let me bring Elvis in line with Buddhist teachings that most people have never heard. Now, please Google the words, five signs of decay. Now, the five signs of decline is displayed by heavenly beings when their lives are about to end. Now, these signs differ according to sutras. Now, sutras or suttas are the Buddhist writings. Now, the Nirvana Sutra. Now, the Nirvana Sutra is the last sutra that the Buddha Shakyamuni wrote. In fact, in the Nirvana Sutra, the Buddha Shakyamuni said his most important things, and he says in the Nirvana Sutra, put faith in the law and not in persons. This is how we practice the Buddhist teachings. Now, in the Nirvana Sutra, it talks about the five signs of decay. Number one, it says their clothes become soiled, number one. Number two, the flowers on their head wither. That means the hair. Three, their bodies become dirty and smell bad. Number four, they sweat under their armpits. And number five, they do not feel happy wherever they may be. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the life of Elvis Aaron Presley. Why is this knowledge important? This knowledge is greatly important to black people in America. What you must understand is that Elvis Aaron Presley was afflicted with the five signs of decay. Now, what is more important than knowing that Elvis was afflicted with the five signs of decay is to know and understand why Elvis Aaron Presley suffered the five signs of decay. In common street terms, this means you are a marred man who is scheduled for a horrible death. You see, the hate and low-down treatment that white people do and did to black people do not get unnoticed by the gods. See, Elvis Aaron Presley suffered immense karmic retribution for the slander and pain that he caused and continue to cause to black people. Let me share this idea with you. Now, I am a filmmaker. In fact, I am the first person in Mississippi, Tennessee, and Arkansas, or the Mid-South area, to write, produce, and direct a 35mm independent film. And I have the idea or the desire to one day do the movie called Elvis Presley, the black side of Elvis, rather. Now, there is a great and an enlightened side of Elvis Presley that we don't hear about. All we hear about is the unenlightened or the delusional side of Elvis Presley. Now, let me explain a few things about Elvis Presley. When I was a kid, Elvis Presley was a hero to black people. Elvis was so loved by black people that he was called one of us. Elvis Presley took a lot of pain and abuse for his association with black people. You see, the civil rights movement started just down the road in 1956 when a 14-year-old black youth by the name of Emmett Till was brutally assassinated for allegedly whistling at a white woman in Money, Mississippi. Clearly, Elvis had an association with black people in that 2 months earlier, in June of 1956, Elvis went to the Fairgrounds amusement park during the days of segregation, and he went to the fair on colored night. Now,
well, you ain't another colored rabbit. You ain't no friend of mine.
There is no room in this city for the vulgar performances of Elvis Presley.
It's shocking. I watched him gyrate his legs and swivel his hips. And our parent-teachers group feels he should not be on television.
Weaver set up a 20-man committee to do away with this vulgar, animalistic, nigger rock and roll bop. Our committee will check with the restaurant owners and the cafes to see what Presley Records is on their machines and then ask them to do away with them.
You've learned anything from the criticism leveled at you?
No, I haven't.
You haven't, huh?
Because I don't feel that I'm doing anything wrong.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog, you cry all the time.
Rock and roll has got to go. And go it does at KWK. We're all through playing rock and roll records. This week is record-breaking week here at KWK. And after this week, no more rock and roll will be played on the air.
The obscenity and vulgarity of the rock and roll music is obviously a means by which the white man and his children can be driven to the level with a nigger. It is obviously nigger music.
Please understand that it was in 1957 where we find the new Elvis Presley, where they carefully crafted his image. We can say, starting in 1957, a 22-year-old Elvis Presley agreed to a racist marketing pact, whereas Elvis became part of the Southern establishment. He understood that he was no longer to be photographed or to be considered friendly to black people. Let me explain to you about Whitehaven, where his home called Graceland sit. Whitehaven was originally a racist white community whose name implies its intent. The original charter of Whitehaven was organized to stop the encroachment of black people. Whitehaven was a haven for white people, and this community helped to solidify the new and refined Elvis Presley image, meaning unless you were the made darkest, stay out of Graceland. Please understand, you see, the Elvis Presley phenomenon presents African Americans with a devastation, a crime that is so horrific that one day African Americans will stand up and challenge the Elvis slander and his racist acts made to black people in America. The Elvis Presley phenomena is a slander to Black America, USA. White people did not hate rock and roll. White people hate the fact that the music comes from black people. Via Elvis Presley, white people seek to change the history of rock and roll and give it a white face. Elvis Presley was a beautiful face and the white face of America. Rock and roll is a black inheritance, a gift from God. Black people in America face the greatest inhumanity of humanity in American history. The gods gave black people the spirit of song and dance. Elvis Presley loved the black spirit of song and dance so much that he, even as a white teenager, visited the Black Baptist Church, Trigg Avenue Baptist Church, to learn the spirit of black music. Imagine a white man transcending differences in the eyes of God at a Christian church where Elvis was bestowed the black or the spirit of black culture expression, whereas he could set the world on fire. Elvis Presley went on to slander black people because he slandered the black ancestors who, via their pain and suffering, came up with rock and roll music. This feeling is best expressed via the 13th century Japanese Buddhist sage Nichiren Shonin. See, Nichiren writes in a letter to Nikkei, it says, quote, "If someone were to kill our parents and then try to offer us some gift, could we possibly accept it? Not even wise persons or sages can avoid the hell of incessant suffering if they accept offerings from slanderers, nor should you associate with slanderers. For if you do, you will share the same guilt as they. This you should fear above all." Unquote. You see, when white people, as Elvis Presley, killed the parents of black people by changing the history of rock and roll, we black people cannot accept an Elvis who killed our parents via they trying to change history. You see, most African Americans hold an aversion to Elvis Presley. We do not dislike Elvis the person. We dislike Elvis the institution. While Elvis Presley was not a racist, the Elvis institution represents white racism and cultural imperialism or white hegemony. White America did not hate rock and roll. White America hated its association, or white America had to redefine rock and roll, and they created a white rock and roll institution, whereas they knighted Elvis Presley, king of rock and roll. Elvis Presley became the conduit for white music segregation and the new face of rock and roll. See, white people called rock and roll the devil's music. They called it nigger music. Now, what the whites had to do was put a white face on rock and roll and appropriate rock and roll. Now, what happened was, about in 1958, what we see is the new and improved Elvis Presley, who stopped taking pictures with black people, who stopped associating with black people, and Elvis Presley followed Southern protocol and went along with the racist whites who made him a king, and he took credit and he became the instigator or the initiator of a stolen legacy against black people. Now, thanks to Elvis Aaron Presley, white America changed the face of rock and roll from black history and culture to a white rock and roll king. You see, Elvis Presley, as a white teenager, went to black Trigg Avenue Baptist Church to worship with black people. And he used to listen to the sermons of Dr. Herbert Brewster. Elvis had a black barber. He used to hang out with Calvin Newborn. He used to eat dinner at Calvin Newborn's house. Elvis would travel right across the Mississippi River to West Memphis, Arkansas, to hear Calvin Newborn play at a place called the Plantation Inn, where he, his father played drums, and his son, Finis Newman, played the piano. You see, in regards to black history, what is the one thing that black people have that got us through slavery, Jim Crow laws, and the worst inhumanity against humanity? You see, it was the voice of sounds and song and dance that got black people through. It is a song and the voice that inspires. Now, black folk was in that cotton field, and they could not take no more. And they would hear a sound, and they could not make it no more, and a song would come in and inspire. Now, white people could not understand that here you are in that cotton field and you're struggling, and they got a whip on you and they're about to kill you to get this cotton crop out, and you're in pain and misery in that cotton field. And you hear somebody else and you can't go no more, and one guy says, and they break out on me. Sing grace, how sweet sound that received a wretch like me. I was lost, but now I'm found. You see, it's the music that brought black people out of misery. It was the music, it was the song, it was the dance that got black people out. Music and song and dance. This is the legacy that the guards gave black people. You see, white people used to say, them niggas is happy. Slaves were not happy, but it was a song and dance that our ancestors gave us to get us through. Now, we got this 19-year-old white boy who re-recorded the song of a black man by the name of Arthur Big Boy Cooter. That song was first recorded in 1946. It was called That's All Right. This white boy, who used to listen to the song at 11 years old, re-recorded that song. And because a white man could do the song That's All Right, the whites call it genius. For the sake of this lecture, I want you to hear Arthur Big Boy Cooter's version, recorded in 1946. And I want you to hear Elvis' version, recorded in 1954. Elvis cannot play guitar like Arthur Cooter. He lacks the bottom and the bass, and Elvis goes flat and sounds like a hillbilly. Hear this for yourself.
Mama, that's all for you. That's all right, no mama. Any way you do, but that's all right. That's all right. That's all right now, mama. Any way you do.
The white fear. The white fear was integration and equality and an end to the white way of living. It is clear that Elvis Aaron Presley appropriated the culture, the music, and the spirit of black expression. What was the word, or what is the word that best explained Elvis Presley in regards to black music? The word is ungracious. See, look up the word. In Buddhism, being ungracious is a slander and a grave sin. We hold that it was Elvis Presley's slander of ungraciousness that led Elvis to experience the five signs of decay or his painful death. See, the Nirvana Sutra and the Buddha Shakyamuni last sermon says what? Their clothes become soiled. Now, let's deal with their clothes becoming soiled. According to Elvis Presley's autopsy, the diameter of Elvis' colon was 5 to 6 inches, which is about double the size of a typical person's. Instead of being 4 to 5 feet long, his colon was 8 to 9 feet in length. The doctor, Nicophilus, said, "We found stool in his colon, which had been there for 4 or 5 months because of poor motility of the bowel." Dr. Nicophilus noted that Elvis had inherited a condition called bowel paralysis, which made defecating difficult. In plain and simple terms, the brother could not go to the bathroom and take a crap, so he had to hold this stuff in him for 6 months. Now, he would be on stage and he would get embarrassed and he would have accidents and have to go change clothes. Now, the number two is the flowers on the head becomes Winter. If you look at the picture of Elvis as he was dead, you could look and tell that his hair was withered. He had lost his hair, or the life in his hair. Number three, their bodies become dirty and smell bad. If you go and research about Elvis Presley and you go into that room or you read anything about the way Elvis smelled prior to his death, you did not want to smell like Elvis Presley because the man had a funky smell. The man was really, really funky. Now, let's go to number four. They sweat under their armpits. If you see Elvis Presley, man, the man drips under his armpits with funk and sweat. And number five, they do not feel happy wherever they may be. You see, Elvis Presley, with all the wealth and with all of the money and the adoration of people, Elvis Presley was the most miserable and sad man because he was afflicted with the five signs of decay. And he got these five signs of decay is because the man slandered the black legacy. He took this black legacy with all the money, fame, and glory. Elvis Presley, the white king of rock and roll, died in miserable death. Elvis never toured internationally. Elvis Presley did make a success, it was the same success as our president, Donald J. Trump, who is supported by white nationalists, the Klan, and whites who gravitate to a white America of yesterday. To study Buddhism is to awaken. The word namo means to awaken. The word myo means correct. It also means wonderful. Now, the word ho means low, and renge means, or the symbol, a lotus flower of the law of cause and effect. And the word kyo means to overcome delusion. You see, what is the purpose of Buddhism? Buddhism is to teach us to be an enlightened people. You see, what most African Americans do not know, and they will not teach you this in the history book. You see, when you look at Rolling Stone magazine, they are making millions of dollars because the advertisers and the white Elvis or the white American cultural institutions support Elvis as the king of rock and roll. That is white cultural hegemony. That is white cultural imperialism. Now, if you study Buddhism, and true history is Buddhist history, because Buddhism means understanding the true facts of history. Now, what we are not taught and what you're not taught in school. See, all of America's original music was created by black people. I mean all of it, from the rock and roll to the acid rock to the country and western. All of America's original music and dance comes from black people. What I want you to do, I want you to hear the words of a young man who broke Elvis's record, the man who is the real king of rock and roll, who sold 10 times as many records as Elvis Presley. That young man is Michael Jackson. Listen to Michael Jackson tell you that all of the history, all of the song, all of the dance comes from black people. They don't teach you this in the history books. They teach you about Elvis Presley. Let's listen to Michael Jackson, and we're going to come back and put a period on this lecture.
I'm tired. I'm really, really tired of the manipulation. I'm tired of how the press is manipulating everything that's been happening in this situation. They do not tell the truth. They're liars. And they manipulate our history books. The history books are not true. It's a lie. The history books are lying. You need to know that. You must know that. All the forms of popular music, from jazz to hip hop to bebop to soul, you know, to you talk about the different dances, from the cakewalk to the jitterbug to the Charleston to breakdancing. All these are forms of black dancing. What's more important than giving people a sense of escapism? And escapism meaning entertainment. What would we be like without a song? Okay? What would we be like without a dance? These things are very important. But if you go to the bookstore down the corner, you won't see one black person on the cover. You'll see Elvis Presley. You see the Rolling Stone. But where are the real pioneers who started? Otis Blackwell was a prolific, phenomenal writer. He wrote some of the greatest Elvis Presley songs ever. And this was a black man. Then I started breaking the all-time record in record sales. I broke Elvis's records. I broke Beatles' records. The minute it became the all-time best-selling album in history in the Guinness Book of World Records, overnight, they called me a freak. They called me a homosexual. They called me a child molester. They said I tried to bleach my skin. They made everything to turn the public against me. This was all complete conspiracy. You have to know that. I know my race. I just look in the mirror. I know I'm black.
I would like to end this lecture with a teaching via a Japanese word called zurihobini. This passage is from the Gosho, the Expedient Means and Lifespan chapter. Please look this up. It reads, quote, "When we scrutinize the sutras and treatises with care, we find that there is a teaching about the precept known as following the customs of the region that corresponds to this. The meaning of this precept is that so long as no seriously offensive act is involved, then even if one were to depart to some slight degree from the teachings of Buddhism, it would be better to avoid going against the manners and customs of the country. This is the precept expounded by the Buddha. It appears that some wise men who are unaware of this point," unquote. You see, we as African Americans, it is the Buddha Shakyamuni who teaches us that in order to practice this Buddhism, we should practice Buddhism according to the local laws and customs. We are black people. We don't do songs like the SGI Sensei. Man, we are the baddest singers and writers and poets and rappers. This is what we do, and this is our culture. Not acting like some Japanese. It is us black people who will propagate Buddhism the right way, with song, with dance. This is the correct way. This is zurihobini. This is what the Buddha admonished us to do. So, let's conclude this lecture with the idea of introducing black music or black culture into Buddhism. And I did this years ago, and I'm going to go out with the Black Buddhist rap song, and I want you to check it out. And we want those of you who really want to get off into Buddhism and make our black history, culture, and language inclusive. This is what we do by writing rap songs. And I did this, my first rap song, went something like this. I found myself a brand new mission to teach others a exciting new religion. Not the religion that you respect, it's all about the laws, the cause and effect. Devotion to the mystic laws and call effect teaching. We do a lot of wisdom preaching. No more life with any drama. We chat the words and change our karma. Check it out! Since I've joined NSA, I have changed my views of society. And I have rekindled my desire to attain the American
dream. Knock your ring gate door, it's the way the rich karma go. Knock your ring gate door, it's the way the rich karma go. Knock your ring gate door, it's the way the rich karma go. Knock your ring gate door, it's the way the rich karma go. Knock your ring gate door, it's the way the rich karma go. Knock your ring gate door, it's the way the rich karma go. Knock your ring gate door, it's the way the rich karma go. Knock your ring gate door, it's the way. I found myself a brand new mission to help others make a big decision. Ring to you as no sort of religion.
It's not the religion that you expect. It's all about the laws of cause and effect. Vultures in the middle of the call of teaching. We do a lot of wisdom preaching. No more life with any drama. We change the words and change our karma. We bring to you the new world away. We bring to you the new way to pray. After long prayers, a lot of meditation. I bring to you the Buddhist conversation. We can change our human relations. We bring to you the culture integration. It's about peace and love and changing situations. This channel in Buddhism makes a lot of sense. It's about self-development and enlightenment. Man, I made the decision to join the Buddha way. I joined the Buddha said, call it as fate. Buddha's new to America and like a tree. What does the world such a China admit? The function to the middle of the call of any teaching. A different learning from a Christian preaching. Buddha's religion that makes a lot of sense. Self-development and enlightenment. Becoming a Buddha's aid is a good decision. Look at yourself and find the inner wisdom. The function to the middle of the call of any teaching. Why we only have Japanese preaching? The Buddha's religion is the way to go. I will find our leader in Tokyo. I want it to move the way. Nation, I should follow sensei. I no longer do it his way. Went to a temple called Taisekichi. The courage of the temple don't relate to me. In 2014, I left the Buddha temple. I teach the Buddha, that's more simple. Little shoe man said, you don't have the knowledge. I want you to check my logic. The only way I teach Buddhism, I give the people a good rhythm. I'm not like a priest at the temple. I teach Buddhism and make it simple. You don't need a cutter to explain it. Singing and dancing is the middle of the language. Function to the middle of the color of education. We teach the rhythm with the preaching. We can teach the rhythm all of the owning. We follow the rhythm that you not shown it. Teach with the rhythm and don't need a mouth. We know how to sing and rap. Let me bring some good news to ya. We translate the Lotus Sutra. You don't have to practice here and after. Just know the second and 16th chapters. Come have a person be in Maria. Learn that Lotus Sutra title. Nam myo ho renge kyo. That's the way that your karma go. Nam myo ho renge kyo. That's the way that your karma go. I don't care how the Japanese do it. I'm gonna put a little soul to it. I don't give a damn. Don't agree. I practice the way that's really me. I respect and love ya. I'm gonna practice up Buddhism with my own culture. I know you hate my dance and all the jerking. You really gonna be upset when I start my twerking. We don't follow the rules and we do no rehearsing. The Buddhists ain't follow the law and no persons. I don't care if my Buddhist practice don't suit you. We follow the law, and the Lotus Sutra. Your karma go. Nam myo renge kyo.